Celebrated Crimes, Volume 2, The Massacres of the South, by Alexandre Dumas. Chapter 2, Part 2. But while this parley was going on, the conspirators had approached the chateau, and thus received the valiant answer to their demands sooner than Monsieur de Laveze had counted on. Resolving not to leave him time to take defensive measures, they dashed at the house, and by standing on each other's shoulders reached the room in which Monsieur de Laveze and his entire family had taken refuge. In an instant the door was forced, and the fanatics, still reeking with the life-blood of Abbé de Chaila, began again their work of death. No one was spared, neither the master of the house, nor his brother, nor his uncle, nor his sister, who knelt to the assassins in vain, even his old mother, who was 80 years of age, having from her bed first witnessed the murder of all her family, was at last stabbed to the heart. Though the butchers might have reflected that it was hardly worth while thus to anticipate the arrival of death, who, according to the laws of nature, must have been already at hand. The massacre finished, the fanatics spread over the castle, supplying themselves with arms and underlinen, being badly in need of the latter, for when they left their homes they had expected soon to return, and had taken nothing with them. They also carried off the copper kitchen utensils, intending to turn them into bullets. Finally, they seized on a sum of 5,000 francs, the marriage portion of Monsieur de Laveze's sister, who was just about to be married, and thus laid the foundation of a war fund. The news of these two bloody events soon reached not only Nîmes, but all the countryside, and roused the authorities to action. Monsieur le Comte de Broglie crossed the upper Cévennes, and marched down to the bridge of Montvert, followed by several companies of fusiliers. From another direction, Monsieur le Comte de Peria brought 32 cavalry and 350 infantry, having enlisted them at Marveillol, La Cornogue, Chiac, and Severette. Monsieur de St. Paul, Abbé de Chaila's brother, and the Marquis de Chaila, his nephew, brought 80 horsemen from the family estates. The Count of Morangiez rode in from St. Alban, and Malthieu, with 2 companies of cavalry, and the town of Menda, by order of its bishop, dispatched its nobles at the head of 3 companies of 50 men each. But the mountains had swallowed up the fanatics, and nothing was ever known of their fate, except that from time to time a peasant would relate that in crossing the Cévennes he had heard at dawn or dusk, on mountain peak or from valley depths, the sound going up to heaven of songs of praise. It was the fanatic assassins worshipping God. Or occasionally at night, on the tops of the lofty mountains, fires shone forth which appeared to signal one to another, but on looking the next night in the same direction, all was dark. So Monsieur de Broglie, concluding that nothing could be done against enemies who were invisible, disbanded the troops which had come to his aid, and went back to Montpellier, leaving a company of fusiliers at Collet, another at Ayres, one at the bridge of Montvert, one at Barre, and one at Pompidon, and appointing Captain Poole as their chief. This choice of such a man as chief showed that Monsieur de Broglie was a good judge of human nature, and was also perfectly acquainted with the situation, for Captain Poole was the very man to take a leading part in the coming struggle. He was, says Père Louvre-Louel, priest of the Christian doctrine and cure of Saint-Germain de Calberta, an officer of merit and reputation, born in Ville d'Hubert, near Carcassonne, who had when young served in Hungary and Germany, and distinguished himself in Piedmont in several excursions against the Barbets, a name applied first to the Alpine smugglers who lived in the valleys, later to the insurgent peasants in the Cévennes. Translator's note. Notably, in one of the later ones, when entering the tent of their chief, Barbanaga, he cut off his head. His tall and agile figure, his warlike air, his love of hard work, his hoarse voice, his fiery and austere character, his carelessness in regard to dress, his mature age, his tried courage, his taciturn habit, the length and weight of his sword all combined to render him formidable. Therefore, no one could have been chosen more suitable for putting down the rebels, for forcing their entrenchments, and for putting them into flight. Hardly had he taken up a position in the market town of La Barre, which was to be his headquarters, than he was informed that a gathering of fanatics had been seen on the little plain of Fontmorta, which formed a pass between two valleys. He ordered out his Spanish steed, which he was accustomed to ride in the Turkish manner, that is, with very short stirrups, so that he could throw himself forward to the horse's ear, or backward to the tail, according as he wished to give or avoid a mortal blow. Taking with him 18 men of his own company and 25 from the town, he at once set off for the place indicated, not considering any larger number necessary to put to rout a band of peasants, however numerous. The information turned out to be correct. 100 reformers led by Esprit Seguier had encamped in the plain of Fondmort, and about 11 o'clock in the morning one of their sentinels in the defile gave the alarm by firing off his gun and returning back to the camp, shouting, "To arms!" But Captain Poole, with his usual impetuosity, did not give the insurgents time to form, but threw himself upon them to the beat of the drum, not in the least deterred by their first volley. As he had expected, the band consisted of undisciplined peasants, who once scattered were unable to rally. They were therefore completely routed. Poole killed several with his own hand, among whom were two whose heads he cut off as cleverly as the most experienced executioner could have done, thanks to the marvelous temper of his Damascus blade. At this sight, all who had till then stood their ground took flight, Poole at their heels, slashing with his sword unceasingly till they disappeared among the mountains. He then returned to the field of battle, picked up the two heads and fastening them to his saddle bow, rejoined his soldiers with his bloody trophies. That is to say, he joined the largest group of soldiers he could find, for the fight had turned into a number of single combatants, every soldier fighting for himself. Here he found three prisoners who were about to be shot, but Poole ordered that they should not be touched. Not that he thought for an instant of sparing their lives, but that he wished to reserve them for a public execution. These three men were Nouvel, a parishioner of Vaillant, Moise Bonnet of Pierre Mal, and Esprit Seguier, the prophet. Captain Poole returned to Barre, carrying with him his two heads and his three prisoners, and immediately reported to Monsieur Juste de Baville, intendant of Languedoc, the important capture he had made. The prisoners were quickly tried. Pierre Nouvel was condemned to be burnt alive at the bridge of Montvert, Maurice Bonnet to be broken on the wheel at Deveze, and Esprit Seguier to be hanged at André de Lanchis. Thus those who were amateurs in executions had a sufficient choice. However, Moise Bonnet saved himself by becoming Catholic, but Pierre Nouvel and Esprit Seguier died as martyrs, making profession of the new faith and praising God. 2 days after the sentence on Esprit Seguier had been carried out, the body disappeared from the gallows. A nephew of Laporte named Roland had audaciously carried it off, leaving behind a writing nailed to the gibbet. This was a challenge from Laporte to Poole, and was dated from the camp of the Eternal God in the desert of Cevennes. Laporte, signing himself Colonel of the Children of God who seek liberty of conscience. Poole was about to accept the challenge when he learned that the insurrection was spreading on every side. A young man of Veljeux, 26 years of age, named Solomon Couderc, had succeeded Esprit Seguier in the office of prophet, and two young lieutenants had joined Laporte. One of these was his nephew Roland, a man of about 30, pockmarked, fair, thin, cold, and reserved. He was not tall, but very strong and of inflexible courage. The other, Henri Castanet of Massavac, was a keeper from the mountain of Legol, whose skill as a marksman was so well known that it was said he never missed a shot. Each of these lieutenants had 50 men under him. Prophets and prophetesses, too, increased the pace, so that hardly a day passed without reports being heard of fresh ones who were rousing whole villages by their ravings. In the meantime, a great meeting of the Protestants of Languedoc had been held in the fields of Auvers, at which it had been resolved to join forces with the rebels of the Cevennes, and to send a messenger thither to make this resolution known. Laporte had just returned from La Venange, where he had been making recruits, when this good news arrived. He at once sent his nephew Roland to the new allies with power to pledge his word in return for theirs, and to describe to them, in order to attract them, the country which he had chosen as the theatre of the coming war, and which, thanks to its hamlets, its woods, its defiles, its valleys, its precipices, and its caves, was capable of affording cover to as many bands of insurgents as might be employed, would be a good rallying ground after repulse, and contained suitable positions for ambuscades. Roland was so successful in his mission that these new soldiers of the Lord, as they called themselves, on learning that he had once been a dragoon, offered him the post of leader, which he accepted, and returned to his uncle at the head of an army. Being thus reinforced, the reformers divided themselves into three bands in order to spread abroad their beliefs through the entire district. One went towards Soustelle and the neighborhood of Alais, another towards Saint-Privat and the bridge of Montvert, while the third followed the mountain slope down to Saint-Romain, Le Pompidou, and Barre. The first was commanded by Castanet, the second by Roland, and the third by Laporte. Each party ravaged the country as it passed, returning death blow for death blow and conflagration for conflagration, so that hearing one after another of these outrages, Captain Poul demanded reinforcements from Monsieur de Broglie and Monsieur de Baville, which were promptly dispatched. As soon as Captain Poul found himself at the head of a sufficient number of troops, he determined to attack the rebels. He had received intelligence that the band led by Laporte was just about to pass through the valley of Croix, below Barre, near Temelague. In consequence of this information, he lay in ambush at a favorable spot on the route. As soon as the reformers, who were without suspicion, were well within the narrow pass in which Poul awaited them, he issued forth at the head of his soldiers and charged the rebels with such courage and impetuosity that they, taken by surprise, made no attempt at resistance, but thoroughly demoralized, spread over the mountainside, putting a greater and greater distance at every instant between themselves and the enemy, despite the efforts of Laporte to make them stand their ground. At last, seeing himself deserted, Laporte began to think of his own safety, but it was already too late, for he was surrounded by dragoons, and the only way of retreat open to him lay over a large rock. This he successfully scaled, but before trying to get down the other side, he raised his hands in supplication to heaven. At that instant, a volley was fired, two bullets struck him, and he fell head foremost down the precipice. When the dragoons reached the foot of the rock, they found him dead. As they knew he was the chief of the rebels, his body was searched. 60 louis was found in his pocket and a sacred chalice, which he was in the habit of using as an ordinary drinking cup. Poul cut off his head and the heads of 12 other reformers found dead on the field of battle, and enclosing them in a wicker basket, sent them to Monsieur Juste de Baville. The reformers soon recovered from this defeat and death, joined all their forces into one body, and placed Roland at their head in the place of Laporte. Roland chose a young man called Couderc de Marcel Rozada, who had assumed the name of Lafleur, as his lieutenant, and the rebel forces were not only quickly reorganized but made complete by the addition of 100 men raised by the new lieutenant, and soon gave a sign that they were again on the warpath by burning down the churches of Bousquet, Cassagne, and Prunay. Then first it was that the consuls of Menda began to realize that it was no longer an insurrection they had on hand, but a war, and Menda being the capital of Gévaudan, and liable to be attacked at any moment, they set themselves to bring into repair their counterscarps, ravelins, bastions, gates, portcullises, moats, walls, turrets, ramparts, parapets, watchtowers, and the gear of their cannon, and having laid in a stock of firearms, powder, and ball, they formed 8 companies, each 50 strong, composed of townsmen and a further band of 150 peasants drawn from the neighboring country. Lastly, the States of the province sent an envoy to the king, praying him graciously to take measures to check the plague of heresy which was spreading from day to day. The king at once sent Monsieur Julien in answer to the petition. Thus it was no longer simple governors of towns nor even chiefs of provinces who were engaged in the struggle. Royalty itself had come to the rescue. Monsieur de Julien born a Protestant, was a member of the nobility of Orange, and in his youth had served against France and borne arms in England and Ireland when William of Orange succeeded James II as King of England. Julian was one of his pages and received as a reward for his fidelity in the famous campaign of 1688 the command of a regiment which was sent to the aid of the Duke of Savoy, who had begged both England and Holland to help him. He bore himself so gallantly that it was in great part due to him that the French were forced to raise the siege of Coney. Whether it was that he expected too much from this success, or that the Duke of Savoy did not recognize his services at their worth, he withdrew to Geneva, where Louis XIV, hearing of his discontent, caused overtures to be made to him with a view to drawing him into the French service. He was offered the same rank in the French army as he had held in the English, with a pension of 3,000 livres. Monsieur de Julien accepted, and feeling that his religious belief would be in the way of his advancement, when he changed his master, he changed his church. He was given the command of the valley of Barcelonnette, whence he made many excursions against the Barbets. Then he was transferred to the command of the Avennes, of the Principality of Orange, in order to guard the passes, so that the French Protestants could not pass over the frontier for the purpose of worshipping with their Dutch Protestant brethren. And after having tried this for a year, he went to Versailles to report himself to the king. While he was there, it chanced that the envoy from Gévaudan arrived, and the king, being satisfied with de Julien's conduct since he had entered his service, made him Major General, Chevalier of the Military Order of St. Louis, and Commander-in-Chief in the Vivarais and the Cevennes. Monsieur de Julien, from the first, felt that the situation was very grave, and saw that his predecessors had felt such great contempt for the heretics that they had not realized the danger of the revolt. He immediately proceeded to inspect in person the different points where Monsieur de Broglie had placed detachments of the Tournon and Marseille regiments. It is true that he arrived by the light of 30 burning village churches. Monsieur de Broglie, Monsieur de Baville, Monsieur de Julien, and Captain Poole met together to consult as to the best means of putting an end to these disorders. It was agreed that the royal troops should be divided into two bodies, one under the command of Monsieur de Julien to advance on Alais, where it was reported large meetings of the rebels were taking place, and the other, under Monsieur de Brogue, to march about in the neighborhood of Nimes. Consequently, the two chiefs separated, Monsieur le Comte de Broglie at the head of 62 dragoons and some companies of foot, and having under him Captain Poole and Monsieur de Dourville, set out from Cavarac on the 12th of January at 2 a.m., and having searched without finding anything, the vineyards of Nimes and La Garrigue de Milhau took the road to Bridge of Lunel. There he was informed that those he was in search of had been seen at the chateau of Caudillac the day before. He therefore at once set out for the forest which lies around it, not doubting to find the fanatics entrenched there, but contrary to his expectations, it was vacant. He then pushed on to Valverde, from Valverde to Beauvoisin, from Beauvoisin to Generac, where he learned that a troop of rebels had passed the night there, and in the morning had left for Arbor. Resolved to give them no rest, Monsieur de Broglie set out at once for this village. When halfway there, a member of his staff thought he could distinguish a crowd of men near a house about half a league distant. Monsieur de Broglie instantly ordered Sieur de Gibertin, Captain Paul's lieutenant, who was riding close by, at the head of his company, to take 8 dragoons and make a reconnaissance in order to ascertain who these men were, while the rest of the troops would make a halt. The little band, led by its officer, crossed a clearing in the wood and advanced towards the farmhouse, which was called the Mas de Garfarel, and which now seemed deserted. But when they were within half a gunshot of the wall, the charge was sounded behind it, and a band of rebels rushed towards them, while from a neighboring house a second troop emerged, and looking round, he perceived a third lying on their faces in a small wood. These latter suddenly stood up and approached him, singing psalms. As it was impossible for Monsieur de Gibertin to hold his ground against so large a force, He ordered 2 shots to be fired as a warning to De Brogue and advanced to meet him, and fell back on his comrades. Indeed, the rebels had only pursued him till they had reached a favorable position on which they took their stand. Monsieur De Brogue, having surveyed the whole position with the aid of a telescope, held a council of war, and it was decided that an attack should be made forthwith. They therefore advanced on the rebels in line, Captain Poole on the right, Monsieur de Dourville on the left, and Count Broglie in the center. As they got near, they could see that the rebels had chosen their ground with an amount of strategical sagacity they had never till then displayed. This skill in making their dispositions was evidently due to their having found a new leader, whom no one knew, not even Captain Poole, although they could see him at the head of his men, carbine in hand. However, these scientific preparations did not stop Monsieur de Brogue. He gave the order to charge, and adding example to precept, urged his horse to a gallop. The rebels in the first rank knelt on one knee so that the rank behind could take aim, and the distance between the 2 bodies of troops disappeared rapidly, thanks to the impetuosity of the dragoons. But suddenly, when within 30 paces of the enemy, the royals found themselves on the edge of a deep ravine which separated them from the enemy like a moat. Some were able to check their horses in time, but others, despite desperate efforts, pressed upon by those behind, were pushed into the ravine and rolled helplessly to the bottom. At the same moment, the order to fire was given in a sonorous voice. There was a rattle of musketry, and several dragoons near Monsieur de Broglie fell. "Forward!" cried Captain Poole. "Forward!" And putting his horse at a part of the ravine where the sides were less steep, he was soon struggling up the opposite side, followed by a few dragoons. "Death to the son of Belial!" cried the same voice which had given the order to fire. At that moment a single shot rang out. Captain Poole threw up his hands, letting his saber go, and fell from his horse, which instead of running away, touched his master with its smoking nostrils, then lifting its head, neighed long and low. The dragoons retreated. "So perish all the persecutors of Israel!" cried the leader, brandishing his carbine. He then dashed down into the ravine, picked up Captain Poole's saber, and jumped upon his horse. The animal, faithful to its old master, showed some signs of resistance, but soon felt by the pressure of its rider's knees that it had to do with one whom it could not readily unseat. Nevertheless, it reared and bounded, but the horseman kept his seat, and as if recognizing that it had met its match, the noble animal tossed its head, neighed once more, and gave in. While this was going on, a party of Camisards, a name given to the insurgent Calvinists after the revocation of the Edict of Nantes, translator's note, and one of the dragoons had got down into the ravine, which had in consequence been turned into a battlefield, while those who remained above on either side took advantage of their position to fire down at their enemies. Monsieur de Dourville, in command of the dragoons, fought among the others like a simple soldier and received a serious wound in the head. His men beginning to lose ground, Monsieur de Brogue tried to rally them, but without avail, and while he was thus occupied, his own troop ran away. So seeing there was no prospect of winning the battle, he and a few valiant men who had remained near him dashed forward to extricate Monsieur Dourville, who, taking advantage of the opening thus made, retreated, his wound bleeding profusely. On the other hand, the Camisards, perceiving at some distance bodies of infantry coming up to reinforce the royals, instead of pursuing their foes, contented themselves with keeping up a thick and well-directed musketry fire from the position in which they had won such a quick and easy victory. As soon as the royal forces were out of reach of their weapons, the rebel chief knelt down and chanted the song the Israelites sang when, having crossed the Red Sea in safety, they saw the army of the Pharaoh swallowed up in the waters, so that although no longer within reach of bullets, their defeated troops were still pursued by songs of victory. Their thanksgivings ended, the Calvinists withdrew into the forest, led by their new chief, who had at his first assay shown the great extent of his knowledge, coolness, and courage. This new chief, whose superiors were soon to become his lieutenants, was the famous Jean Cavalier. Jean Cavalier was then a young man of 23, of less than medium height, but of great strength. His face was oval with regular features, his eyes sparkling and beautiful. He had long chestnut hair falling on his shoulders and an expression of remarkable sweetness. He was born in 1680 at Ribaut, a village in the diocese of Alais, where his father had rented a small farm, which he gave up when his son was about 15, coming to live at the farm of Saint Andiol near Mende. Young Cavalier, who was only a peasant and the son of a peasant, began life as a shepherd at the Sieur de la Combes, a citizen of Vezenobre. But as the lonely life dissatisfied a young man who was eager for pleasure, Jean gave it up and apprenticed himself to a baker of Anduze. There he developed a great love for everything connected with the military. He spent all his free time watching the soldiers at their drill and soon became intimate with some of them, amongst others with a fencing master who gave him lessons and a dragoon who taught him to ride. On a certain Sunday, he was taking a walk with his sweetheart on his arm. The young girl was insulted by a dragoon of the Marquis de Flore's regiment. Jean boxed the dragoon's ears, who drew his sword. Cavalier seized the sword from one of the bystanders, but the combatants were prevented from fighting by Jean's friends. Hearing of the quarrel, an officer hurried up. It was the Marquis de Flore himself, captain of the regiment which bore his name. But when he arrived on the scene, he found not the arrogant peasant who had dared to attack a soldier of the king, but only the young girl who had fainted, the townspeople having persuaded her lover to decamp. The young girl was so beautiful that she was commonly called La Belle Isabeau, and the Marquis de Florac, instead of pursuing Jean Cavalier, occupied himself in reviving Isabeau. As it was, however, a serious affair, and as the entire regiment had sworn Cavalier's death, his friends advised him to leave the country for a time. La Belle Isabeau, trembling for the safety of her lover, joined her entreaties to those of his friends, and Jean Cavalier yielded. The young girl promised him inviolable fidelity, and he, relying on this promise, went to Geneva. There he made the acquaintance of a Protestant gentleman called Ducer, who, having glassworks at the Mas Aritas, quite near the farm of Saint Andiol, had undertaken several times at the request of Jean's father, Jerome, to convey money to Jean, for Ducer went very often to Geneva, professedly on business affairs, but really in the interests of the Reformed faith. Between the outlaw and the apostle union was natural. Ducer found in Cavalier a young man of robust nature, active imagination, and irreproachable courage. He confided in him his hopes of converting all Languedoc and Vivarais. Cavalier felt himself drawn back there by many ties, especially by patriotism and love. He crossed the frontier once more disguised as a servant in the suite of a Protestant gentleman. He arrived one night at Anduze and immediately directed his steps to the house of Isabeau. He was just about to knock, although it was 1 o'clock in the morning, when the door was opened from within and a handsome young man came out, who took tender leave of a woman on the threshold. The handsome young man was the Marquis de Florac. The woman was Isabeau, the promised wife of the peasant, had become the mistress of the noble. Our hero was not the man to suffer such an outrage quietly. He walked straight up to the Marquis and stood right in his way. The Marquis tried to push him aside with his elbow, but Jean Cavalier, letting fall the cloak in which he was wrapped, drew his sword. The Marquis was brave and did not stop to inquire if he who attacked him was his equal or not. Sword answered sword, the blades crossed, and at the end of a few instants the Marquis fell, Jean's sword piercing his chest. Cavalier felt sure that he was dead, for he lay at his feet motionless. He knew he had no time to lose, for he had no mercy to hope for. He replaced his bloody sword in the scabbard and made for the open country. From the open country he hurried into the mountains, and at break of day he was in safety. The fugitive remained the whole day in an isolated farmhouse, whose inmates offered him hospitality. As he very soon felt that he was in the house of a co-religionist, he confided to his host the circumstances in which he found himself, and asked where he could meet with an organized band in which he could enroll himself in order to fight for the propagation of the Reformed religion. The farmer mentioned Generac as being a place in which he would probably find 100 or so of the brethren gathered together. Cavalier set out that same evening for this village and arrived in the middle of the Camisards at the very moment when they had just caught sight of Monsieur de Broglie and his troops in the distance. The Calvinists, happening to have no leader, Cavalier, with governing faculty which some men possess by nature, placed himself at their head and took those measures for the reception of the royal forces of which we have seen the result, so that after the victory to which his head and arm had contributed so much, he was confirmed in the title which he had arrogated to himself by acclamation. Such was the famous Jean Cavalier when the royalists first learned of his existence through the repulse of their bravest troops and the death of their most intrepid captain. The news of this victory soon spread through the Cevennes, and fresh conflagrations lit up the mountains in sign of joy. The beacons were formed of the Chateau de la Bastide, the residence of the Marquis de Chambonat, the church of Samson, and the village of Groupière, where of 80 houses only 7 were left standing. Thereupon, Monsieur de Julien wrote to the king, explaining the serious turn things had taken, and telling him that it was no longer a few fanatics wandering through the mountains and flying at the sight of a dragoon whom they had to put down, but organized companies well led and officered, which if united would form an army 1,200 to 1,500 strong. The king replied by sending Monsieur le Comte de Montrevel to Nimes. He was the son of the Maréchal de Montrevel, Chevalier of the Order of the Holy Spirit, Major General, Lieutenant of the King in Bresse, and Charolais, and Captain of 100 men-at-arms. In their struggle against shepherds, keepers, and peasants, Monsieur de Brogue, Monsieur de Julien, and Monsieur de Baville were thus joined together with the head of the House of Beaune, which had already at this epoch produced 2 cardinals, 3 archbishops, 2 bishops, a viceroy of Naples, several marshals of France, and many governors of Savoy, Dauphine, and Bresse. He was followed by 20 pieces of ordnance, 5,000 bullets, 4,000 muskets, and 50,000 pounds of powder, all of which was carried down the river Rhone, while 600 of these skillful mountain marksmen, called Miquelets, from Roussillon, came down into Languedoc. Monsieur de Montrevel was the bearer of terrible orders. Louis XIV was determined, no matter what it cost, to root out heresy and set about this work as if his eternal salvation depended on it. As soon as Monsieur de Baville had read these orders, he published the following proclamation. The king, having been informed that certain people without religion bearing arms had been guilty of violence, burning down churches and killing priests, His Majesty hereby commands all his subjects to hunt these people down, and that those who are taken with arms in their hands or found amongst their bands be punished with death without any trial whatever, and their houses be razed to the ground and their goods confiscated, and that all buildings in which assemblies of these people have been held be demolished. The king further forbids fathers, mothers, brothers, sisters, and other relations of the fanatics or of other rebels to give them refuge, food, stores, ammunition, or other assistance of any kind, under any pretext whatever, either directly or indirectly, on pain of being reputed accessory to the rebellion, and he commands the Sieur de Baville and whatever officers he may choose to prosecute such and pronounce sentence of death on them. Furthermore, His Majesty commands that all the inhabitants of Languedoc, who may be absent at the date of the issue of this proclamation, return home within a week, unless their absence be caused by legitimate business, in which case they shall declare the same to the commandant, the Sieur de Montrevel, or to the intendant, the Sieur de Baville, and also to the mayors and consuls of the places where they may be, receiving from the latter certificates that there is a sufficient reason for their delay, which certificates they shall forward to the above-mentioned commandant or intendant. And His Majesty furthermore commands that said commandant and intendant to admit no foreigner or inhabitant of any other province into Languedoc for commercial purposes or for any other reason whatsoever, unless provided with certificates from the commandants or intendants of the provinces whence they come, or from the judges of the royal courts in the places whence they come, or from the nearest place containing such courts. Foreigners must be provided with passports from the ambassadors or ministers of the king accredited to the countries to which they belong, or from the commandants or intendants of the provinces, or from the judges of the royal courts of the places in which they may be at the date of this proclamation. Furthermore, it is His Majesty's will that those who are found in the aforesaid province of Languedoc without such certificates be regarded as fanatics and rebels, and that they be prosecuted as such and punished with death, and that they be brought for this purpose before the aforesaid Sieur de Baville, or the officers whom he may choose. Signed, countersigned, Louis Philippot. Given at Versailles, the 25th day of the month of February, 1703. Monsieur de Montrevel obeyed this proclamation to the letter. For instance, one day, the 1st of April, 1703, as he was seated at dinner, it was reported to him that about 150 reformers were assembled in a mill at Carmes, outside Nîmes, singing psalms. Although he was told at the same time that the gathering was composed entirely of old people and children, he was nonetheless furious, and rising from the table gave orders that the call to horse should be sounded. Putting himself at the head of his dragoons, he advanced on the mill, and before the Huguenots knew that they were about to be attacked, they were surrounded on every side. It was no combat which ensued, for the Huguenots were incapable of resistance. It was simply a massacre. And certain number of the dragoons entered the mill sword in hand, stabbing all whom they could reach, whilst the rest of the force stationed outside before the windows received those who jumped out on the points of their swords. But soon this butchery tired the butchers, and to get over the business more quickly, the marshal, who was anxious to return to his dinner, gave orders that the mill should be set on fire. This being done, the dragoons, the marshal still at their head, no longer exerted themselves so violently, but were satisfied with pushing back into the flames the few unfortunates who, scorched and burnt, rushed out, begging only for a less cruel death. Only one victim escaped. A beautiful young girl of 16 was saved by the marshal's valet. Both were taken and condemned to death. The young girl was hanged, and the valet was on the point of being executed when some sisters of mercy from the town threw themselves at the marshal's feet and begged for his life. After long supplication, he granted their prayer, but he banished the valet not only from his service, but from Nîmes. The very same evening at supper, word was brought to the marshal that another gathering had been discovered in a garden near the still-smoking mill. The indefatigable marshal again rose from the table, and taking with him his faithful dragoons, surrounded the garden, and caught and shot on the spot all those who were assembled in it. The next day it turned out that he had made a mistake. Those whom he had shot were Catholics, who had gathered together to rejoice over the execution of the Calvinists. It is true that they had assured the marshal that they were Catholics, but he had refused to listen to them. Let us, however, hasten to assure the reader that this mistake caused no further annoyance to the marshal, except that he received a paternal remonstrance from the Bishop of Nîmes, begging him in the future not to confound the sheep with the wolves. End of chapter 2, part 2.